This episode is part of our ongoing series with Queen's University Belfast, where we have the chance to sit down with an interesting student, professor, or graduate once a month to hear and share their story. To find out more and listen to all the other episodes and conversations in this series, please visit bestofbelfast.org/Queens. Today, I had the absolute pleasure of sitting down with Eileen Murphy, a professor of archaeology and a leading expert in ancient human remains and burial practices. Her real passion is for telling the stories of ordinary people whose voices have been largely written out of history, and she's also the author and editor of 12 books, including a book all about Takabuti, the Belfast mummy who's currently living in the Ulster Museum, who, as you'll hear, inspired Eileen to get into archaeology as a child. In today's episode, we talk all about growing up with a sense of awe and adventure about the world around her, some of the weird and wonderful things discovered right here on our doorstep, what the past can teach us about the present, the rights of the living versus the rights of the dead, why a sense of place is an essential part of our well-being, lessons learned from studying thousands of human skeletons, and the greatest highs and lows of her journey so far. Thanks so much for being here, and we really hope that you enjoy. What did you have for breakfast?
I had whole grain toast with free-range egg. And I know they're free-range egg because they came from my hen.
Ooh! So, yeah, you don't need to trust anybody else's standards. No, you know exactly.
I know. And can I just say, they're very special hens because they come from a rescue centre, nut house.
Oh, wow.
Rescue centre in Moira, where this is Barbara... Next level. She rescues, hens that have come to the end of their life in the egg producing industry. And then people like me come and we adopt them. And they have a lovely wee life, you know, roaming free. And they're brilliant wee layers.
Class. So. Well, I mean, this sounds like the type of box of eggs you could sell for like a fiver. It's got all the layers to it. It's got the free range. It's got the rescue chicken. I mean, people are into that.
People are. And do you know what? They're the best wee pets. They're lovely, lovely wee nature and produce great eggs. And I mean, I'm plugging this because I thoroughly recommend people to go and rescue some wee ex-battery hens or ex-farm.
My wife's going to hate you already. I am like in the middle of trying to turn. For some reason, I don't know if it was a lockdown thing, just really got into like wanting to grow vegetables and like producing some of your own food. And look at all this, you know, you have a garden and what's it used for other than grass, you know, and you need to do something else with it. Absolutely. And chickens is the next thing on the list.
I know, and we were the same, aren't we? Got into vegetables and all during lockdown, but I've had hens for quite a while. And I actually think it's in my genetics because my granny, both my grannies would have had hens, you know, and my granny down in Derrygonley in Fermanagh. She actually had her own wee industry.
Oh, wow.
And a lot of women, you know, in those days, early mid 20th century, you know, that was their way of generating their own income, you know, as well as feeding their family. So I love the way I've kind of connected to her that way. You know.
That's interesting because I've seen a lot in the entrepreneurial space, say in countries like Africa, it's all about getting people, you know, an animal to generate an income for their family. And it is women as well. You know, they'll like, you know, I remember saying like a pig business. You know, I don't know, a pig costs maybe 15 quid over there. And if they can get a pig, they can basically spin it into a whole business. And then, you know, the pigs have babies and then they've got themselves like an empire. And you're like, wow. We were like that too, you know.
Absolutely. And that's the way, I mean, obviously, I'm an archaeologist. That's the way people in the past would have existed. You know, there was none of this going out to the supermarket and buying a ready meal. Everything they had to either, you know, they had to gather the materials and make the houses and, you know, grow their own crops, harvest them, turn them into bread or whatever.
Yeah.
And the same with all the animals. You know, they had to raise them and ensure they kind of had the circle of life continuing, you know, so that their supplies didn't die out.
Yeah.
So the human-animal-land interaction is incredibly important, you know, past, present and future.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy to me because, you know, here I am with a couple of raised beds, mainly growing salads. And I'm like, oh, how cool. I'll not have to buy salads for, you know, 4 months out of the year. But if you think about it, like, if all your supermarkets disappear and you and your family are responsible for feeding you and your family... Mm-hmm. Like, I can't even begin to imagine where you would start, never mind doing that with a whole community, you know. And that's how people lived.
I know.
It was a collection of really large families that worked the land and had to be strategic about planting stuff. And if the crops failed, it was really, really bad news, like, you know.
No, definitely. People in the past, like, they did have very close community bonds, you know, and in some of the eras that I study, like the early medieval period, there would have been fosterage practices and, you know, that would have even further enhanced community connections and, you know, say...
what does that mean? What's fosterage?
Fosterage is when you... your child is sent off to be reared by another family, so not blood relatives.
Yeah,
And they seem to have done that across all different social classes.
Interesting,
you know. And but it meant then that there were really tight knit communities because it wasn't just blood relations; it was all these fosterage connections. And one of the populations we studied in recent years, most of the adults were dying when they were very young. You know, so between 18 and 35. So we think that that might have been a way then to cope with all the orphaned children. You know, as well. So there's kind of good sense, you know, to have tight knit communities working together, you know, to support each other.
Yeah, if the family unit or if the parent unit is not sustainable because the parents keep dying so young, you kind of need to find a different system to manage the child rearing, don't you?
Absolutely. Interesting. You know? And if you think today, you know, a lot of we expect people to live into old age, so we expect to have grandparents, even great grandparents. But, you know, in the past, they would have still had some people, you know, and maybe people would have been grandparents younger. But it would have been a very different way of dealing with sort of intergenerational relationships.
Do you think that's why elders were so respected historically? Because they were so, like, in short numbers. And if they were, you know, if you had grey hair, you were walking around and everyone was like, whoa, this person has lived long enough to get grey hair.
I definitely think, yeah, there would have been great respect to older people. But you have to as well remember, you know, we rely very much on the written word and you know, books and obviously now the internet. But it would have been, you know, information that was being passed down from generation to generation in the past. So the older people would have potentially been the greatest repositories of that knowledge. Wow. So that would have been really important, you know, even just in their storytelling capabilities and passing down traditions and legends and practicalities to the younger generations.
Yeah, don't ask Google, ask Granda.
Exactly. You can imagine them, you know, if they're maybe infirm and sort of inside their cottage with all the kids sitting around listening to them, and them also then looking after those children so their parents could go out and work.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting. Like, it's almost back to that idea that it takes a village to raise a child. Do you know what I mean? And like the community links and the inbuilt support were phenomenal there. I'm curious, like, what was your experience like growing up? Like, were the people around you interested in archaeology? Was that something that you were fascinated by from a young age, or did that come later? Speak a wee bit to that.
Okay, so I think my parents have obviously greatly influenced me, and they both had an adventurous spirit, shall we say. So when they got married, they decided they weren't going to just stay in Northern Ireland. They went off to Zambia for a couple of years.
Oh my goodness.
And they worked as teachers, and then I was born out there.
What?
Yeah, so I kind of had that, I suppose, an exotic start, you know? And they gave me my second name. People always see, like, Eileen M. Murphy, and they probably think it's like Mary or Margaret or some Irish name, but it's actually Masonda.
Oh, wow.
So that's my, you know, wee legacy of where I was born.
What does Masonda mean?
Okay, so Mum always said it was a god or goddess. You know, it was one of these, it was neither male nor female. But if you look on Wikipedia, there's actually a few more different, there's one definition was pioneer, and another one was the taster. So I kind of found that quite intriguing.
I like that. I like both of those definitions.
Yeah, and it was actually, I never thought of doing that. It was actually one of my colleagues, Dr. Jerry Miller, who pointed this out to me quite recently.
Wow.
So he taught me something new.
The pioneer and the taster.
Yeah, so there you
That's
go.
That's cool.
So yeah, so I think...
I wonder if the god, you know...
was the god of food.
Yeah, you know, or, you know, if there was some sort of a link to that, that would be interesting.
I do. I need to do a bit
You
got
to do a bit of digging there,
I do
you?
Need to now, That's yeah. Fun. But so they were both, you know, pretty adventurous.
Well, absolutely,
you know,
yeah.
Obviously, like... 1969, when they got married, it was sort of the troubles here, so they wanted to escape for a bit.
Yeah, but there's a difference between going over to England and going to Zambia.
Going to Zambia, I know, and I don't think my dad had had much experience of being outside the country.
Wow.
Your mum had travelled around Europe, but so yeah, so they kind of didn't do it in half measures, they just went for it. So, and then we always travelled, you know, when I was a kid during the summer, and so I think that kind of... notion of exploring was instilled in me in a young age. And even just, like I said before, exploring our local countryside. You know, I loved getting out and round and looking for, I don't know, special stones and going into caves and just out around the landscape. And I do remember now spent the summer at my cousin's, and my uncle obviously thought we needed something to do, and we were out excavating up an old brass bed. We spent a whole summer excavating this treasure, you know. So that was, again, us out in the countryside. I think it was an old bed that was like in a ditch or you know, in a laneway to kind of give a firm footing.
So what is it about you? Okay, so go back to the brass bed, and you've got, let's say, three children the same age doing the same project. One of them will love it for 10 minutes and then be like, this is the worst thing ever. The second one will do it out of a sense of duty because they'll, you know, they're hard-willed and they really want to just get the job done. And then there's maybe a third child that's like, just sees the magic to it all. What is it about you that, like, even that brass bed, the fact you remember it, why was it so enjoyable?
I just think it was really exciting. I think I've always been kind of inquisitive. And I mean, he'd obviously told us this was treasure, so sure. And it was shiny, you know.
So
that was really exciting. But I think, I don't know, I think I always liked thinking about the past, you know. And I remember like a school trip from our wee primary school at Killyhaman in Bow. And we went out and we went for a walk around the loch that was beside us. And there was a crannog on the loch. And I just remember being blown away by this idea that people had made an island to live on.
Crazy.
You know, so those were kind of, you know, in my context, little experiences that kind of, I think, paved the way for what I would end up becoming. And another, when I was very young, we lived in Glengormley before we moved to Fermanagh.
Oh, cool.
And Takabuti in the Ulster Museum, she...
A very influential woman in your life.
Absolutely. No, I mean, I can just remember Mum taking me and my cousin Joanne, and she'd take us to the Ulster Museum because I think she knew it was somewhere she could enjoy wandering about, and we would just do our own thing and wander about. And Joanne and I would always have made a beeline to go and see Takabuti. And, you know, I remember just...
Who is Takabuti for people who don't know?
Okay, so Takabuti is a mummified Egyptian woman who's on display in the Ulster Museum. So she's now got a lovely room of her own, you know, surrounded by...
Luxury.
You know, Egyptian objects. But when I was like a 6-year-old or whatever, 7-year-old, she was in, I just remember it being this big black space, and you had to go up big black steps, and she would sort of appear out of the gloom. And I remember being a bit scared, but more absolutely intrigued and fascinated by who is this amazing woman that's lying in front of me. And there were some bits of information, but it didn't really talk about Takabuti. It talked about ancient Egypt and life in ancient Egypt. Mm-hmm. So I have to say that one of my real dreams come true was to actually get to study Takabuti, to learn more about her, you know, as a person, who she was. So this was a project. It started off back about 2006, 7, 8, around then, when the Ulster Museum closed. Do you remember there was the major period of refurbishment? And Ian Dugan, who's sadly now passed away, he got in touch with me because he wanted to do like a documentary about Takabuti, because like me, he had been totally enthralled by her when he was a child. And and he really had this idea that he wanted to know what her face was like. What did she look like when she was alive? So that kind of started the whole process. And, you know, we got a team that was from Queen's University Belfast and the University of Manchester, and we came together, and Takabuti went on a road trip over to Manchester. She got on a lorry and then on a bus, and she was recorded, you know, x-rayed and CT scanned over in the University of Manchester. And we learned a lot of information about her during that period. You know, there was a strange package in her chest, and we thought at that time maybe it was her heart, because the heart was the ticket to the afterlife. And if you didn't have your heart, you couldn't go before the god Osiris and get weighed against your heart and the feather of truth. Because if you were a good person in life, your heart would be nice and light. If you were a bad person, your heart would be heavy, and then you get thrown into this sort of devil creature, the devourer. But if you were good, you could go on into the afterlife. But anyway, so... We'd learned that, and we'd learned, you know, about her hair, and that, you know, she had her own hair and it was curled and cut before she, you know, around the time of her death. But then it sort of all came to a halt, and the project resumed again then just over the last couple of years, 2018. So It was a project that was funded by the Friends of the Ulster Museum and the Queen's Engaged Research Fund. And basically, we were allowed into the museum on a day that was closed, and Takabudi's room was turned into almost like an autopsy room. So she was taken out of her coffin, and Dr. Robert Loynes from the University of Manchester, he basically used a biopsy needle and was able to take samples. And Mark Reagan, who's from Kingsbridge Private Hospital up the Lisburn Road, he brought his x-ray machine in, and we were able to record her and get really precise samples. And,
wow.
And Mark was another one who, as a kid, used to go to see Takabudi all the time, and she really inspired him. So basically, all of the information came together, and we produced a book, and I've got a copy for you.
Oh, yes.
There's your very
Come
own
on.
Copy.
Thank you so much.
The Takabudi.
There's the face. There she is.
Isn't she beautiful?
She is great.
So, so it was Rosalie David, the Manchester lead, and myself. We kind of coordinated the book, but it's got contributions by, you know, everybody who was involved in the project. So, you know, we talked about the history and when she came to Belfast in 1834 and, you know, where her body has been, you know.
Why on earth did she come to Belfast?
She came to Belfast because a man called Thomas Gregg, he bought her basically at a mummy market. So
what? A mummy market?
Yeah, so he would have been a wealthy young man. I think his father was the High Sheriff of Antrim.
Wow.
And as part of their education, wealthy men and women would have been sent out, you know, around Europe to kind of increase their educational experience and become more cultured and different things. But sometimes they went as far as Egypt. And one of the prize possessions then, the prize sort of souvenir, was to get a mummy or a piece of a mummy. Mm. So Thomas Gregg bought Takabudi. But now, thankfully, he brought her back to Belfast. And instead of just having her on display in his house, which a lot of them would have done.
Sure.
He donated her to the Belfast Naturalist History Society.
Wow.
And they were absolutely delighted because they were trying to sort of build up their collections, And she was, so they had established the Belfast Museum, I think it was in 1831. So just a few years previously. So she then became, you know, a prized display in their museum. And she was unwrapped in 1835 down in the museum. So there's still, you can see the room upstairs, and it's got a lovely balcony. And you can just imagine like all the sort of the delegates standing around. So this was overseen by the Reverend Dr. Edward Hinks, who was a great genius. He was the rector of Killyleagh, but he was able to interpret hieroglyphs and cuneiform.
Oh my
and
goodness.
He was doing this amazing work from a rectory in Killyleagh, you know, when all his kind of rivals would have been working in places like Oxford and Cambridge and, you know, having all the humongous resources available to them. So he was able to then. So you can just imagine all these great men standing around and, you know, going to then study Takabudi. And they had an artist there who did a painting of her before she was unwrapped. And Davis, the Belfast man, he wrote a couple of poems about her as well. So it was real media, a frenzy.
Wow.
And we know about it from newspaper accounts of the day. So the Belfast newsletter has a big spiel about what happened. And Edward Hinks translated the hieroglyphs on her coffin and said that her name was Kabuti. And then this was later changed to Takabudi. Her father was a priest of Amun. So he was called Nesper. And then her mother was called Tassinirit. It said that Takabudi was the lady of a great house and the mistress of a house. So she probably was married, but we don't know if she had any children, and we don't know anything about her husband.
Mm-hmm.
And then they sort of described her bandaging, and they talked about her being very petite. You know, she is only about 5'1", and they talked about her hair. They were even able to sort of identify that her bandages were made from linen rather than flax. And I mean, Belfast at that time would have been Lineopolis and, you know, big centre of flax, of linen production. And they just talked about her features, and they did phrenology. Have you heard of that?
Never.
Okay, so it's kind of when they analyse the shape of a person's head or skull.
Okay.
To kind of, so you, sometimes you see those kind of busts, you know, you've got a skull and then it's got writing on it and it's all apportioned. So that's what they did. And it was believed to be a genuine science. So they said about her, you know, I think loving animals and children and being a person of great character, but of little or no taste, which I thought was, I must admit, I like that. It's a poor old Takabudi had bad taste.
Oh, absolutely, you know? No Masonda, like.
So the big shocker was that she had a weapon injury.
Oh.
So poor Takabudi, who I always thought looked extremely peaceful and serene in her coffin, she'd actually had a big blow, like an axe blow to her, the back of her, her back on the left shoulder. And we think that probably killed her from catastrophic bleeding.
Madness.
And then the mysterious package that we'd discovered, you know, 10 odd years ago, turned out to be like a plug, like a cloth plug to maybe staunch the bleeding and stuff, you know, pack the wound. Because Bob Loins, he found that her heart was still in its right place.
Oh,
and it
wow.
had been taken out, wrapped up and put back in. So you had the heart in the middle and then this pack over at the left.
Interesting.
So, so it looks like she was maybe running away from an assailant. She lived at a time of great conflict, you know, between the Nubians and the Assyrians. So maybe she was caught up in a war, or we don't really know, you know, why she died, but she died in a violent manner.
And I just love this because it really paints the picture of like how much you can tell. You know, you're like Sherlock Holmes, like looking at like this bit of information and how it links to this bit of information, how that builds the story, how it builds the full case, and how you know you start to reconstruct what could have happened.
I think, well, that's the excitement of archaeology.
Yeah.
You know, with scientific advances, there's more and more we're able to learn all the time. And we've been really fortunate in our department. We've got a massive £3 million grant from AHRC. And that has given us a whole range of new equipment. So we'll be able to undertake, you know, chemical analysis of metal objects, lots of different sort of isotopic analyses, you know, that tell us about diet and the date of people in the past and whether they were local or non-local to an area. And, you know, in my department, there's a lot of colleagues are paleoecologists or physical geographers, and they would be interested in climate change, and they can give like deep time perspectives. And again, all this new equipment is going to really help us to unravel, you know, climate change in the past.
So take me back then, okay? Like, how do you go from going seeing Takaburi in the Ulster Museum as a girl to ending up doing a PhD at Queen's on archaeology? Like, what was your PhD even about?
Okay, so I went to Queen's and did my undergraduate degree there. And I remember, because we would have shared classes in first year with geography students, and I was friends with quite a number of them. And they all thought I was mad, because I remember within a week thinking, this is it. I'm in the right place. After having been a wee bit lost,
yeah.
I knew within a week, and I was sitting there, like it was our professor at the time was Professor Derek Simpson. And I was just like, I was hanging on his every word. I couldn't believe, you know, it was all about Stonehenge and Avebury. So I knew I was in the right field. And I in my undergraduate degree, I specialised in zoo archaeology, which is the study of animal bones. But I really enjoyed that. But I kind of thought, you know, I'm more interested in the people. Mm. So I decided I was going to go to England, do a master's in osteology. And I got the expertise then that I could use to come back and do my PhD.
Class.
So you asked what my PhD was. My PhD was actually in Russia. So
right.
I was really fortunate that a lot of things kind of came together, and my PhD supervisor, Professor Jim Mallory, he encouraged me to go out to Russia.
Well, you mean it was like in Russia?
Yes. So I spent probably about a year PhD living in St. Petersburg, which is just an amazing place. And I worked with my dear colleagues in the Kunstkamera Museum, so Professor Yuri Chistov and Dr. Slava Moiseev and people like that, who are still really good friends of mine. And I looked at about 1,000 people from the Scythian and the Xiongnu period from South Siberia. So these were just incredible nomadic people. So that sort of started me off looking at these large populations and trying to reconstruct what life was like, you know. And, you know, these people would have been quite warfaring. So I did get like early evidence of scalping, and like they had these kind of ice pick type axes, and you find the holes in the skulls that had happened. But it also got me thinking a lot about disability and how people with physical impairments were treated, because, okay, Herodotus talks about all these warfaring things, but then I was finding people, you know, with severely twisted spines or club feet, you know, or, you know, facial deformities. And they would have had these conditions since birth, and they'd obviously been looked after and cared for, you know, because these people were nomads. They'd have had to be lifted in and out of wagons and moving around the steppelands. So it just got me thinking, you know, people maybe are found the kind of the violence aspects sort of, that's, you know, one of the early archaeological textbooks would talk about violence quite a lot and warfaring and all that. But I loved being able to find, you know, other sides to these people.
The humanity.
The humanity, and being able to, you know, look beyond what people like Herodotus was saying and actually then look at the real people, you know. So, yeah.
Absolutely. And it's crazy, you know, even if you look at our own doorstep here, like we kind of, we joked about potatoes at the start, how, you know, it's so easy for us in 2022 to not put faces and stories and humanity to, you know, the historical people right here on our doorstep, like including the famine, you know, which was really crazy. And I know you've done a project around that.
Absolutely. At the moment, we're sort of in this, the 175th sort of anniversary of the Great Famine in Ireland. So we wanted to commemorate this because it's a big landmark occasion. And, you know, on Gort Mór, the Great Famine is one of those defining moments in Irish history. And it really changed the island, you know, economically, socially and even culturally, because there were so many people died and such mass emigration. You know, that's why we've got so many Irish, you know, all around the world.
Half
you know?
America is Irish.
Exactly. But do you know, it would have been a really grim time. So we thought it definitely needed to be remembered.
I can't believe it's only 175 years ago.
I know, that's nothing.
That's kind of shook me, you saying that. Because, you know, I obviously studied the famine and know a good bit about the famine.
Mm-hmm.
175 years is not a long time.
No, that's not. But, you know, a lot of information about the famine has been forgotten because I think people were so traumatised, you know. And that's something you do find that... if a generation has been traumatised, they sort of push things out of their mind, you know, so they look forward and try to get on with their lives.
Well, it's a little bit like how, say, for example, my grandparents, I was born in the 90s, mm-hmm. would maybe be hesitant to talk about aspects of the trouble, mm-hmm. Because it was such recent history for them, yeah. You know.
Well, that's it. It could be uncomfortable discussions. But so we had sort of in 2020, we'd wanted to do a couple of projects to commemorate the famine. So the first was...
Great year for it.
I know. Well, you see, this is where it all went a bit horribly wrong, you know, because obviously COVID struck. So we'd been planning to go out and plant potatoes and we'd been planning to do an excavation of a famine road. So they all had to go on hold. But in terms of our excavation, we were able to get out last summer. So that was 2021. And we decided we were going to go and excavate a famine road in Bow in County Fermanagh. So... we chose Fermanagh because it's where I grew up, so it's an area very, very special to me. But also there's a lot of information about famine roads in this particular area. So we spoke to Mr. Sean McLaughlin, who's a very, very nice landowner, and because we knew there was like a wonderful stretch of a famine road on his land, and him and his family were very supportive and gave us the permission we needed. So we took a group of students from Queen's and staff then from our Centre for Community Archaeology, and we went down last August for a week to excavate this famine road. So I should say, famine roads, they were basically a public work scheme put in place. In Fermanagh, we know that it was a very short-lived thing. It happened between, I think it was October 1846 and then June 1847. So, you know, we know the years, we know the precise months when these schemes were in operation. And basically, the government didn't want to give the poor food for nothing. Mm-hmm. So they decided, right, we'll get them to work for their food. Now, you can imagine, bad idea. You've got people who were starved, full of, you know, diseases brought on by hunger, and they weren't going to be in any fit state to go out and build a road. But anyway, the government at the time thought this was a great idea, and then they introduced these schemes all across the island. But like I say, we focused in sort of the Bow area, Bow Derrygonly area in Fermanagh. Now, we knew from the government records that they had a very strict plan to how these roads would look. So they could be either 21 feet across or 24 feet, so that's about 7 metres across. And they could have then like little fences at either side, or some of the bigger ones like little footpaths. So we kind of set out to just see, did the engineers on the ground, so it would have been a guy called Roderick Gray in this part of Fermanagh, did they follow that exact plan? We've got quite a lot of accounts as well that tell us about conditions on the roads, and they sounded really grim. So, you know, you had people had to arrive at work at 6 and they worked 6 a.m. and worked till 6 p.m. And they had a long day with 1 hour of a break. And If they didn't arrive at 6 a.m, they got a quarter of their pay for the day docked. If they didn't arrive at 9 a.m, they got half docked. And if they arrived later than that, that was it. You didn't get paid. And because people were so desperate, you've got these awful accounts, you know, of people basically standing around the edges, kind of waiting for somebody to die.
Yeah.
So that they could then take their place. And you've got accounts, you know, which make it sound quite cruel, the regime, you know, people being whipped if they weren't working hard enough.
Oh, wow.
So you can imagine, like, these starving people, you know, being whipped, trying to move, you know, loads of clay and mud and stones. It would have just been horrific.
It's like the Prince of Egypt, flip me.
I know, it's really grim. So that was kind of the context. So we set up, we opened up our trench and we found that the road hadn't been completed. So there was just a clay layer that hadn't even got round as far as putting the stone cap on top. So that was a bit of a surprise. So It just maybe is an indicator that the scheme ended very abruptly. And we also found no artifacts. And that's a real shocker for
<That's a shame.
laughs> for archaeology, because normally we would find
something.
It's rubbish. We find the rubbish that people threw away. And that to us is gold, you know.
Yeah.
And I was in my mind expecting, you know, there might be the odd clay pipe, you know, for people smoking on the roads, you know, and or maybe, you know, evidence of food or the odd animal bone or something. But to find nothing, and I think that really was a real stark indicator to us that this was horrific and that people had nothing to throw away. One of the things as well, we knew about this amazing stretch of road in the field, and we really wanted the community in Bow to sort of pay it attention, you know, and think about it, you know, because they've got this really precious memorial in their landscape. And we were really, really delighted with the community response. You know, we had lots of volunteers coming out to work on the excavation.
Oh, wow.
Which is, it's lovely because it's...
That's awesome, yeah.
You know, it's their archaeology. You know, it's mine as well because I'm from Famine.
Yeah. But, did you pay them in food or... Not what you're
No, they all did it for the goodness
Incredible.
Of being part
What
of
a thing to do though, like on an afternoon or a Saturday, you know.
Very cool. it was amazing. You know, we had young people who were maybe aspiring archaeologists and then older people as well. Yes. And we just had a steady stream of people visiting. There was one of the local historians, Sister Adele Bannon. She told us a really interesting story when we were on the site. And because she just lived up the road, she grew up the road. And she said, you know, when we were kids, we'd always run past this field because there was always like an eerie atmosphere.
Ooh.
And we kind of wondered, you know, is that folk memory? You know, people have sort of, they knew there was something in the field, maybe not necessarily remembered exactly what it was, but they knew it was somewhere where it was a place of sorrow and something terrible happened. So we thought that was quite interesting, you know, how that wee story had kind of percolated across time.
Folk memory is so fascinating, isn't it?
It is. Really.
You know, we talked about this on another show recently where, you know, they maybe didn't even have the scientific background to understand why certain things happened, like certain diseases or certain catastrophes. So the storytelling engine of the human brain was how they would pass on pieces of advice and kind of keep people in check and create boundaries. It's really, really crazy.
Oh, absolutely. And I think folklore and folk practices and traditions and all, they're so important to keep alive, you know, to help us understand the past. Because, you know, as archaeologists, we can find things, you know, and sites and, you know, remains of people and a lot of different material things. But whenever you've got those stories, it can really, you know, help us to make sense of what we find.
I heard something gorgeous recently, and it said something like, storytellers use lies to tell the truth.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought
that's
that
a good
was,
way of thinking about
that
it.
Was very cool. The quote went on to say, politicians use the truth to tell lies, but we'll not get into that.
Yeah, so it was a really, really rewarding experience for the whole team.
That's cool.
And we ended on the last evening. We had like an interdenominational service. So we had Father Seamus Quinn, Sister Edel, and Reverend Samson Aduka. They came and they said a few words on the site and, you know, just blessings and remembering the people who had died. And we thought that was really important because it, the famine just killed anybody who was poor. Didn't matter what your religion was. And that sometimes, you know, gets forgotten.
Yeah.
So we just really wanted that message to be kind of remembered, you know.
So, I mean, this is kind of opens up an interesting angle, I suppose. Why do you think it's important that we remember those people Okay, so go back to that community. Would you say Boho and Fermanagh?
Bow. Not Boho.
That's, it's like Soho and Boho.
No, it's Bow. That's the classic mistake.
Bow in Fermanagh. Uh-huh. You know, so let's say, you know, I have a wee house in Bow. You know, I've got a couple of kids and I'm sitting there. You know, how is that going to add value to my life? Or what will I gain from engaging in that sort of remembering and going down and, you know, excavating the ground and all that sort of stuff?
Well, I suppose, like, as I grew, I mean, I grew up in Fermanagh, so the countryside was my playground.
Yeah.
You know, I was out meeting friends at bridges and playing on ancient monuments. And I have a really strong sense of place for where I grew up. You know, I've been living and working sort of in Belfast hinterland, you know, for years, but I still see Fermanagh as my kind of home, you know.
Yeah.
And I just think when people kind of understand, you know, the sites and monuments and the people that came before them and understand the countryside around them, it instills a really strong sense of place and a real pride in an area, you know. And some of the people who came to our site, you know, they were really pleased that we had decided to work in Bow, because sometimes they feel a bit forgotten, you know, these rural communities. They don't really, I mean, we all think they're incredible and the countryside is just beautiful. And, you know, all the farming communities is so important. They're so, the heart of Ireland in many ways.
Yeah.
But it was just, I think they just enjoyed the fact that, you know, archaeologists came out and gave some attention to their area and, you know, physically demonstrated that this is a really important site in a really beautiful and important landscape. And we even had a crowd come over from the Digging for Britain documentary, and it has Alice Roberts. So again, you know, we're telling the story of the famine and the story of, you know, the people of Bow to a kind of a wider audience. So that was kind of, We thought that was really important. And you know, when archaeologists come into an area, you know, there is that sense of excitement. You know, you can't help get away from the whole Indiana Jones. You know, everyone loves, you know, the mystery.
Absolutely.
And the thrill of what we're going to find. Now, you know, some might say, well, you didn't really find very much at the Famine Road. But to us, that really told the story of that particular road. You know, and whenever you can use the kind of historical sources and the local folklore, you know, we've learned a huge amount from that one excavation that took place over a week last summer.
I think it's really interesting to hear how, you know, you're showing up at a site that to the naked eye looks like there's hardly anything going on. But then I almost picture, like, in your mind's eye, like, you start stacking all these extra layers on top. You know, you've got the historical accounts, like you said, which I assume could be things like a journal or whatever. And you're just adding all these layers on top of it, to the point where you're showing up on site on this road and you almost have like this 3D picture of what's going on. You're trying to bring as much life and data to that as possible to kind of create like a full picture. I guess in some ways to kind of like create a time machine to go back and try to understand what was happening.
No, absolutely. And, you know, that's one of the things, I suppose that's one of the things that really appeals to me about archaeology. Because in school, I was one of these kids, you know, I did art and biology and chemistry for my A-levels because I was kind of, I liked everything. I didn't really feel I was a scientist or an arts person.
Yeah.
Although I did end up going to art college for a year and then deciding it wasn't for me and got into archaeology. But I really like the way we kind of take lots of different techniques and approaches from other disciplines and we kind of bring them all together under archaeology and then apply them to questions of the past, because I think it gives us a really, you know, unique way of looking at questions, you know, and we're not afraid to kind of borrow from sort of documentary sources or stable isotopes or DNA, you know, anything that we think is going to be useful. We'll use it.
It's interesting, even like, you know, I think you just round off your A-levels there. Like, they're pretty important components of like your day-to-day job. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, like you kind of almost had like that multidisciplinary nature baked into your character growing up, you know?
Yeah,
that's cool.
You're right, actually. I hadn't actually thought about it that time. You know, you've taught me something.
I'll bill you at the end, don't worry.
No, you're dead right. Because sometimes, you know, people think if you're going to study archaeology, you must have history A-level.
Yeah.
But that, I mean, I'm an example where that's not the case. And a lot of my colleagues would be similar, you know. But yeah, no, I think we definitely always strive to use a multidisciplinary approach in our questions of the past, about people in the past. And, you know, and that's to me what archaeology is all about. It's the people, you know, we, like I said, we look at the remains of what they left behind. But I mean, my main sort of area of work is in bioarchaeology. So that's looking at ancient human remains. So I would mostly look at skeletons, you know, and there's obviously ethical issues to this line of work, but you know, we wouldn't. We the remains that we would be studying are usually excavated because there's going to be like a modern development. So it's usually a road scheme, and invariably, you know, there's been a lot of sort of thought behind the scenes, and you know, legislation enacted, and the goods of the needs of the living are kind of decided that they outweigh the you know, the good
that
of the dead.
That is an ethical dilemma I've never once thought about in my life. Wow.
So I think, you know, I think because I'm working in the in this area, I do think about it a lot, you know. And, you know, as archaeologists, we're extremely privileged to be able to, you know, actually work with the remains of the dead, remains of our ancestors. So we do have a lot of, you know, different rules and regulations and legislation and ethical
codes. Isn't it so crazy that, like,
codes.
You're sitting there with the skeleton and it literally was someone that was walking around, like your great-great-great like nephew or something, do you know what I mean? Like, or uncle, sorry. Like, this person was alive, like you and I are right now, you know, and had conversations like this.
And and that is the critical thing to remember. You know, I mean, and I do, every skeleton that I study, I'm thinking about that person. And, you know, obviously, when we look at a skeleton, we're reconstructing, you know, is it an adult or a child? You know, is it a man or a woman? Mm-hmm. What age were they when they died? What diseases did they have? What injuries may they have suffered from? But I'm always thinking that was a person, you know, and there's times when you come across a skeleton who's maybe, you know, of a child the same age as one of your own kids, you know, and you do have to kind of imagine what would it have been like for the family, you know, losing that child. So I think it's very important to keep the humanity in archaeology. Yeah. And, you know, one of the areas that I'm interested in is looking at burial practices, because then you can really get glimpses of the living and glimpses of emotion. You know, because it was the living who buried the dead and laid them out in their graves. You know, and we sometimes find like little kids are laid out in their sides, or they've got like a little pillow stone, you know, and I think their families were trying to make them look like they were sleeping.
Yeah.
Do you know, so it's not like the formal position that was more commonly used for adults.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you might find like little bits of quartz inside a burial. So it's like a nice white shiny stone that we'd see on modern graves today. Mm. And again, you know, I can just imagine, you know, sorrowing families putting these little stones in, these little symbols, you know, of their kind of love, and even little holy, you know, little kind of little religious items to maybe sort of help the person in the afterlife, you know.
Absolutely.
So so that for me really enriches, you know, the scientific study of skeletons, is remembering the humanity and looking for the emotions.
Yeah.
You know.
It's really interesting. I mean, this is a very, very, very obvious observation. It just kind of struck me there that, like, you know, whenever you die, your body remains at that age. I don't know why it's freaking me out right now, but I'm like, wow, like, if you die a child, your body remains a child. And that, it kind of, you're locked in to that piece of history. And that tells a story that can be told for, you know, in 100 years' time. What's the oldest skeleton you've studied? Or how long do skeletons viably last for them to be of use to? I suppose they're always of use.
Yeah, I mean, let me think. So I suppose, within Ireland, like, our earliest people would be about 10,000 or so years ago. So it's the Mesolithic.
Wow.
But we've only got like a couple of bones from that era, you know. So it's when we move into the Neolithic, so that's when we get all our lovely megalithic tombs that are dotted around the countryside in places like Newgrange.
Mm-hmm.
That's when you start to get, you know, much more skeletal remains, the bones preserve. But within megalithic tombs, they're quite often kind of jumbled up collections of bones, you know. And I've actually, one of my students, Lisa White, for her PhD, she's actually studying a site called Millen Bay, which is over in County Down. And in the 50s, they excavated inside the tomb and they found a whole collection of disarticulated, so just jumbled up bits and pieces of bones. But And they've been then stored in the Ulster Museum for years. But whenever we started looking more closely at these bones, they had lots and lots of cut marks on them. So that tells us, you know, that the people, their bodies were being processed, you know, and sort of maybe their skin taken off and maybe them cut up. And then bits of bone, bits of the body's been put into the tombs. So she's looking at this in more detail and trying to work out, you know, which, you know, trying to map the patterns of cut marks and then trying to sort of work out, you know, why were they doing this and who might have been getting buried in this amazing, you know, megalithic tomb. So that would be sort of a Neolithic person. And a project that I was involved in that sort of hit the headlines a couple of years ago involved the geneticists down in Trinity College Dublin. So it was Professor Dan Bradley and Dr. Lara Cassidy. And it was looking at sort of genetic connections between Neolithic people, but they actually had a piece of bone from inside Newgrange.
Okay.
I don't know if you've ever visited that site. It's an incredible passage tomb down in County Meath. It's like one of our premier sites. And, you know, it's always billed as being older than the pyramids and it's really spectacular. And it would have taken, you know, a lot of effort to actually construct. So needed to be created by somebody who had the resources. But
it's really, I'm probably getting jumbled up. Is this the one that the sun...
Yes, comes no, absolutely. It's got the light box.
So,
so that would be on the 21st of December. So the midwinter kind of solstice, the sun comes through the box and hits the very back of the tomb. So imagine the planning to to create some, you know, an engineering feat to be able to make that.
So precise.
That work, absolutely. You know, and, you know, we do sometimes, I think people don't appreciate the skills of our ancestors, you know, and their intellect and their engineering capabilities and different things.
Well, this is something that I actually wanted to talk about. I've been trying to figure out how I want to phrase this, but it's almost like a generational snobbery.
Yeah.
Where we look down at people from the past as like, oh, weren't they so simple and primitive? You know, and we throw so much of their beliefs and their practices out. You know, we throw the baby out with the bathwater, so to speak. And it's kind of interesting because in a lot of ways I'm like... Yeah, but I feel like they were doing a lot of things better than we currently are today.
No, absolutely. I mean, I'm just sitting here thinking about that and thinking about, you know, like me and like my husband, Colm, you know, our ability to use digital technology, you know, compared to our kids, and they're kind of laughing sometimes at our inability to use it. But but as we talked about, you know, people in the past were extremely resourceful. They were able to survive from the land.
Yeah.
Whereas I don't think we could. We can try our best to grow our vegetables and have our wee hens and things, but...
Well, even a bona fide farmer, I think, would struggle.
Yeah, without the modern
technologies.
Now, obviously, these technologies have advanced to make things easier, but does that mean that we're less resourceful and less capable?
Yeah.
Do you know, because even... You know, people reading books on tablets as opposed to reading a book.
Mm-hmm.
I always say to my kids, you know, what happens if there's like a disaster and electricity goes and we're left here? You're going to have to read a book to entertain yourself.
Yeah, yeah. You know? Or, you know, you've bought 140 books on your Kindle and for some strange reason, I don't know, they get deleted.
Yeah.
say goodbye to your 140 books. Do you know what I mean? Like, how are you going to pass those books down to the next generation? You can't even transfer that book to a family member. You buy the license to that book. You don't actually buy the book. You don't own anything. You own a copy of it, but you can't even donate that copy to your library. Do you know what I mean? So we've moved from this very physical world that you have spent your career digging up to try to find stories about. What will it be like in 1,000 years' time if archaeologists don't have access to our digital clouds, which they probably won't?
No.
You know, I talk about this all the time. If I give you a floppy disk... right now, like, you're going to have to go to a lot of effort to extract that data from it, or a VHS.
Oh, no.
You know, and, you know, we all, like, I don't know about you, but, like, my laptop doesn't even have a CD drive anymore.
I know.
I know. It's just made all that information trapped in these little discs redundant. So it'd be interesting to see, like, what remains are left in 1,000 years' time from this era, you know? Crazy.
I know. It's... Yeah, I suppose even in terms of burial practices, like, I sometimes get, you know, talk to my students about, you know, like, there's so many, I know it hasn't quite happened here yet, but there's so much talk about the green ways of green funerals and, you know, like corpse composting and, you know, sort of is a promethean. It's where, you know, the corpse is sort of liquefied, you know, so getting rid of the body as much as possible,
yeah,
you know, as opposed to burial.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's going to be very few skeletal remains potentially archaeologists in the future. And, you know, I mean, we do find cremated remains in the past. So like in the early Bronze Age, a lot of the burials would have been cremated. But I suppose it's becoming more and more common, you know, in the modern world. And you can still get lots of information from a cremated deposit, mm-hmm. but it's just not quite to the same level as from an unburned body.
Yeah.
And just even like one of my areas of interest is looking at, you know, grave memorials, you know, like in places like the city cemetery, which is incredible. But there's so much pressure now for space and, you know, in those old cemeteries, people could have memorials whatever way they wanted.
Yeah.
You know, these beautiful classic memorials or even like a pyramid or an obelisk or whatever.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But now it's all very sort of, it's formulaic, you know, and more and more cemeteries want like a little plaque on the ground that you can lawnmower, you know. Mm. So all these kind of, these things that are from the past, I think are kind of fizzling out. And I just wonder what it's going to be like in the future.
You ever heard the term, Matthew, wabi-sabi?
No.
Okay, so wabi-sabi is, let's imagine you've got four mugs in your cupboard that you, I was going to say handmade, right? So you took the clay and you, I don't know, whatever you do, you sculpted it and then you fired it. And, you know, even if you followed like the same sort of design, every mug is going to be slightly different.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Versus you buy four mugs from IKEA and there's like a million of them just like it all around the world. They don't mean anything. And I think like as we move forward, everything's getting a little bit less wabi-sabi. So that's what wabi-sabi is. Those little distinct differences that come from kind of that human interaction with the material. And, you know, everything's just become so uniform down to the gravestones. I've never thought about that before. It's you're making me think about a lot of things here.
Yeah, I suppose, I mean, thankfully, like, in some of the cemeteries you go to, like, there is great individualization in gravestones, you know, and people are putting their own spin. So it's almost like they're going back to the Victorian era, but putting a modern slant on it.
Yeah.
And you can see that in the city cemetery as well, where the old graves are kind of almost being replicated in modern style in some of the new graves.
I want to go back to, you know, you talked about the corpse of the child lying on the pillow and the little quartz stones, little white stones, and the religious emblems that kind of, you know, for lack of a better term, help them pass through whatever was waiting for them when they died. Were you talking about that locally?
Yeah, so, I mean,
because it's in my head, obviously, I go to the tombs of the pharaohs in Egypt. But what can you tell us about some of the beliefs or the rituals or the traditions around burials here?
Yeah, so, I mean, that, for example, would be a typical kind of finding in an early medieval or a medieval cemetery here. So, you know, we some of the cemeteries that are excavated are large because of these big road developments. So the one I mentioned was Ballyhanna in County Donegal. So it had about 1,300 people buried in it. So quite a small area, but sort of, you know, over time it kind of built up the burial ground. So you would find, you know, evidence like I was talking about with the children, you know, having particular sort of burial positions. You find lots of evidence for diseases. So diseases like tuberculosis and, you know, people with severe injuries. So there was one man, he'd had this terrible injury. He must have, it's the sort of injury you would get from a modern car crash. So if we think back to what would have been available to him, you know, maybe he fell at speed from a horse or from like a cart or something. But basically his femur, so that's his thigh bone, had been dislocated at the hip and kind of burst through into his pelvis and was sort of locked there. So it would, and then his leg would have been sort of fixed at right angles from his hip, you know, out in front of him and at right angles at his knee. But, you know, for him to be able to survive an injury like that, you know, he probably would have been, you know, bedridden for about 3 months. So every need he would have, you know, everything he needed to survive would have had to be given to him by other people.
Yeah.
And again, this goes back to the idea of close-knit communities, you know, who was going to bring him food, who was going to attend to his toileting and keeping him clean and making sure he didn't get bed sores and making sure he didn't get infections. You know, there must have been a group of primary caregivers, you know, and eventually, even when he did sort of regain mobility, it would have been quite limited, you know, and he had to maybe use crutches And he wouldn't have been a fully functioning adult male anymore in terms of being able to go out and harvest or herd animals.
Yeah, and he's not getting sick pay.
No, absolutely not.
The whole family has lost a huge salary, you know, potentially absolutely. Their livelihood. So there's so many factors there.
But for him to be able to survive, you know, and because we can see in the nature of the lesions on the bones that they weren't fresh, that he'd lived, you know, for probably quite a long time after.
Wow.
That support must have been there. And it's again going back to this idea of, you know, people are people. They're mm-hmm. not too different to ourselves. And if somebody you love has been injured, you're going to do your best to look after them.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless of your resources. So you just do the best with what you've got.
Yeah.
And that's something I see a lot in the skeletons we study, you know, that people did try to look after each other and people did survive some pretty horrific injuries and diseases. And then you'd see like these little special things in their graves, like maybe being positioned in a way that's kind of reminiscent of like a prayer position.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if some people I've seen with tuberculosis are buried almost like they're kneeling, you know, or their hands are in prayer. And I think it's all very deliberate.
Yeah.
You know, on the part of the living.
Absolutely. This might be an impossible question. I don't know because I've got no context for it. If you were to look at my skeleton and compare it with an exact perfect clone of myself that lived in the medieval period or around then, what differences would you see between my skeleton and other Matthew skeleton?
Ooh, that's a tricky. Okay, so I would be putting you into the 18 to 35 young adult category.
Oh, young adult, I love that.
Yeah, so you're a young adult. I would be looking at your skull and your pelvis and then be able to say you're male. So that would be your kind of like biological profile. And then in a person, medieval Matthew, shall we say.
Ooh, I like that, M&M.
I would expect you'd probably have what's called Schmorl's nodes in your spine. So this is when there's pressure put in the disc and it causes kind of these cavities in the vertebrae.
Okay.
And that's caused by very hard work.
Back-breaking work,
yep.
Okay.
And we see that a lot in our young adults and just shows us that people from teenagers, you know, adolescents were engaging in heavy physical labour. You probably wouldn't have beautiful white pearly teeth. You'd probably have pretty bad teeth full of caries, you know, cavities. Mm. You'd probably have lots of plaque sticking to your teeth, which is a bit not nice.
I mean, you haven't seen my teeth. So.
Abscess as well. They look pretty good from here. I'm imagining as well. Abscesses. You might have had the odd broken bone, you know, because of all the work you had to do. And, you know, we can see sort of different patterns of injuries in men and women, you know, which seems to be connected to the chores they would have done on a habitual basis. So like a lot of women seem to have broken fingers and toe bones, you know, and it might be to do with more kind of finer domestic chores, because mm-hmm. the different early medieval tracts kind of indicate that women spent a lot of their work was around the sort of the homestead, you know, and the domestic life, whereas men would have been more likely to go out and be, you know, out in the fields or out mm-hmm. doing construction projects. So things like that. And you probably would have been barefooted, you know, so you might have had an infection in your lower legs. You could have picked up tuberculosis, which is pretty nasty, and you'd be then quite emaciated and spitting up blood and coughing, and things would not be good for your future.
I want to go back to the feet. Okay. Would my toes be different? Because I'm wearing quite tight trainers here and I kind of almost feel them, you know, my toes bunching together, but I just have like big hobbit feet in my head if I'm picturing medieval Matthew.
Well, I suppose your feet wouldn't have been constrained. It could actually be that medieval Matthew's feet are more natural because they're just able to be loose, you know.
Yeah.
But then they would have been more exposed to injuries, and infections and different things. But we do sometimes find bunions, you know, in people in the past. So, you know, that is suggestive of some sort of foot constraints.
Mm-hmm.
So that's
crazy.
That's an interesting observation.
No, I love that. Completely off the cuff as well. I appreciate that. I kind of want to go back to, you know, we've kind of danced around it a couple of times so far. Let's go back to medieval Matthew. You know, what are some areas of his life you think that with a broad brush would be stronger than a modern Matthew walking around today. So don't worry about making it personally about me. But what areas of his life do you think actually they're doing a better job than we are in the modern world?
Well, that's a really tricky question. I suppose, you know, I think even from like my grandparents' generation, I mm-hmm. think our society is now quite detached. You know, we don't, we're sort of all living our lives and not everybody has like intergenerational support.
Yeah.
Whereas medieval Matthew would have probably lived in quite a tight-knit community. He would have been, you know, okay, biologically we call him a young adult, but he would have been, you know, an adult. He'd have been growing up and sure. and one of the guys who would have had responsibility in the community. So you get a sense that people in medieval times, they for survival, they all had to really stick together
yeah.
and provide support. Whereas I suppose in the modern world, things are easier in some senses, but maybe people don't have the same level of support.
I'm just thinking as you're speaking, the image I had in my head was like medieval Matthew walking out to the field or whatever
uh-huh.
and doing so knowing that he had to make money for his wife, his kids, but also the granny and granda yeah. that lived in the house as well, and maybe even a few of these foster kids that were floating around in the mix as well. So it's, yeah. it's a completely different story than just like, oh, Matthew and his little nuclear yeah. family, you know?
No, absolutely. But then if you again think about it in modern terms, like if you have like other, if you're living with, you know, say unmarried sister or brother mm-hmm. or something mm-hmm. or grandparents, if they're still alive, like you have a built-in support network absolutely. For children, you know, so.
Yeah, you don't need to pay for childcare because the childcare is right in the house.
Yeah, so things yeah. like that. And, you know, like, I don't know. Like, our world has so many mental health problems.
It's true.
You know, we don't know what mental health would have been like in the past. But is it that tighter knit communities, I don't know, would they have felt more like they belonged?
I don't know the logic that went into this. But I did read a study recently that said that in the American Amish community, mm-hmm. the rates of depression were 10 times lower.
Okay.
And they obviously live quite an agrarian, tight-knit community. Mm-hmm. And then how they figured this next bit out is beyond my ability. Mm-hmm. But they kind of proposed that in hunter-gatherer communities, that the rates of depression were 100 times less than they are today.
Okay, I wonder how they figured that out.
I wonder how they figured that out. But their kind of overall hypothesis was the community, but also the being outdoors, using your body mm-hmm. a lot, the types of food that they would have eaten, which are obviously kind of flipped on its head to where we are yeah. today. It's interesting.
Well, I mean, you're saying about, you know, archaeology and being outdoors. So that's one of the things our Centre for Community Archaeology, you know, we're very keen to sort of promote the well-being aspects of being involved in archaeological projects, mm-hmm. you know, and that's why we go out, you know, and we've worked with a lot of, you know, like Heritage Lottery funded landscape partnerships and done, you know, excavations out in different communities across Northern Ireland. And it's great. People always say, you know, like heritage volunteers tend to have very high levels of satisfaction and happiness because
interesting.
They've enjoyed being out, you know, outdoors, but then they're also using their mind at the yeah. same time and thinking and exploring and discovering.
Now, do you mean, so that data point of that feeling of satisfaction, are you saying overall in their life they're more satisfied or for this no, 3 hours?
Apparently, overall, you know, people who kind of more regularly get
so that's
involved.
Interesting. So what do you think is different about those who are heritage-minded and orientated? Like what type of people makes them more satisfied than, say, modern Matthew?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think it's more people find it rewarding to be involved in, you know, an excavation because it helps mental health. It helps physical aspects as well.
Yeah.
And I think if they've enjoyed an experience like that, they're more likely to go back and get mm-hmm. involved, you know.
I think I've got a more specific question for you. You touched on this at the start.
Okay.
A sense of place.
Yes.
Do you think that having a sense of place is like more important than we maybe give a credit for in like today's world?
I think so. I think people like to feel like they belong somewhere, you know, and that they understand the landscape around them and they have memories and can connect. And that's not to say people going into an area, newcomers into an area can't create their own sense of space, you know, and a lot of you know, it's not always just like people who've grown up in a place that are interested in what's happened there. You know, anybody can want to find out more, because I suppose it gives then a sense of value to where you live, mm-hmm. and a sense of pride, you know. So I think it's all kind of, it comes together. But I think, you know, being outdoors is obviously, we all know that that's really good for us. But when you add in these other layers of discovery, it makes, it enriches it. You
and
know?
The community that goes along with it.
Absolutely.
You're hitting a lot of the key pillars here. It's good. It's a good ad for getting involved.
I suppose archaeology, you know, it's quite a small community, you know, in Northern Ireland, you know, yeah. in a sense. And like our students in Queens, like they build, because it's a fairly small number, you know, in a degree course, they build an amazing community, you know, and we're always very keen to get them involved in our projects, and they create their own projects, you know, and Archaeology Society go out on all their trips and different things. So I suppose, like, you know, as professionals, we're very high on, big on community. And then we bring that into our projects, and then communities get involved. So you've got all these different kind of communities merging, and it's a lovely experience, you know.
Wow. Very, very cool. Kind of on that note then, like, one of the questions we often ask as part of the series is, and maybe it's an impossible question, or it's hard to kind of narrow it down to one, but what would you say is your most proudest moment or achievement or finding or piece of research or whatever initiative that you have had the chance to be a part of during your time at Queen's?
So I'll talk about my discovery first, and then I'll talk about what I'm proudest of. So in terms of archaeological discoveries, I suppose the moment that stands out for me was actually discovering a case of leprosy, which probably sounds really weird because whenever people ask me, you know, what's the most exciting thing you found, they're expecting me to talk about gold or whatever. Yeah. But for me, because I as a master's student, I was really intrigued to hear that, you know, leprosy was in Europe, Northwest Europe. It was an epidemic sort of disease, or endemic disease at that time. So I was kind of wondering why we didn't have any in Ireland, any cases. So when I was doing my PhD, I took a break to go and work in an excavation at Armagh up in County Antrim inside St. Patrick's Church. And we found a case of leprosy. So it was just a pair of feet preserved. And then that sort of brought Ireland into the story of leprosy. Wow. So, you know, and we all know it's a totally horrific disease.
Yeah.
But it was a bit of a puzzle why it wasn't here. So that was my kind of, for me, the most interesting discovery.
Yeah, for sure.
But I've had so many. You know, I've been so fortunate and blessed in my career so far. In terms of what makes me proudest, I just love seeing the students coming through the system. You know, so I teach the students in first year and then in third year. So I kind of like that I'm there at the very start of their degree when they're all just wee new things in school or wherever they've come from before. It's amazing to see them grow and mature and become really confident in their archaeological abilities because, you know, when they come in, they're going to have been interested in archaeology, but because it's not a subject offered in school, they're all very, very new. And then in third year, they do my Society, Death and Disease course. And I actually, a few weeks ago, had the last lecture for the current cohort. And, you know, it's a bittersweet because you're really proud of them and they've made it to the end, but it's kind of sad to see them go on.
Yeah.
I'm extremely proud of my PhD students as well because three of them have gone on to be lecturers themselves.
Wow.
And again, you know, you're seeing sort of people starting off projects, seeing it through and developing. And I think that's one of the great privileges of working somewhere like Queen's University Belfast. You're very much part of seeing young people develop and, you know, helping them to sort of change into what they're going to be in their careers. You know, and like I've been through it myself, and I was very grateful to my lecturers for helping to shape me as an archaeologist, you know, and I really enjoyed my time as a student in Queen's. And
I mean, all that travelling is amazing. Like, what a thing to do at such a young age, you know?
Well, that's it, you know, and I think, you know, sometimes people think, oh, I'm not going to go to Queen's because I want to travel, you know, but actually I think you can go to Queen's and you can travel the world. The world is your oyster. We actually have some amazing scholarships in the university. So that's one of my roles, which is, it's a great role because you're
giving people money.
Giving people money. So I'm chair of our scholarships and awards group, and I love it because it's a positive thing. You're giving people money to be able to fulfill their dreams and ambitions. So we have a lot of bequests, you know, like the Sir Thomas Dixon bequest and the Sir Emily Montgomery and the Queen's Graduate Association. And a lot of these are to do with excellence. You know, people are rewarded, you know, for achieving really great academic results. But then a lot of them are tied into travel. So people can get to travel, you know, as part of their degrees, or even just to sort of get cultural experience that's going to enhance them, you know, in whatever their subject area is. And I love being able to then read the reports about all their different adventures. And across the different departments and schools in the university, you know, there are a lot of these scholarships that maybe people aren't aware of, but they're just like an extra that helps people.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so moving into the stock questions then, just to wrap things up. And these are choose your own adventures. So take these away, whatever way you want. You can make it personal, you can make it professional, you can throw us a curveball, whatever you feel like. The first one is simply, Eileen, out of everything so far, what would you describe as your most challenging moment? And how were you able to overcome that, if you don't mind sharing?
Gosh, I don't know. Actually, let me think. I don't know. I enjoy the challenge, you know. I think... I suppose I get excited about lots of different things, you know, and suppose for me, sometimes the challenge is to try to focus on one particular thing. You know, I think I've been really fortunate to in my career to be able to, you know, work on an amazing Egyptian mummy like Takabuti. I've had a PhD student who is looking at diseases in dinosaurs. So I've even got the chance to kind of stray into paleontology. And I don't know, I suppose... Sometimes it can be quite emotionally draining when you're looking at somebody, the skeletal remains of somebody who has obviously had a really horrific life, you know, and I'm trying to tell their story. But, you know, I'm a scientist, obviously, but you're kind of wanting to make sure that the human side and the experiences are still in there. So sometimes it can be a challenge to make sure that you're representing these people from the past in the right way, you know. And I think especially when you're dealing with children, it can be very difficult. Actually, I suppose one of the challenging areas I work in, which we haven't talked about, is children's burial grounds or cleany. I don't know if you've ever heard. Have you heard of these?
No.
So scattered across Ireland, there are thousands of little unconsecrated burial grounds. And these are where the unbaptized babies would have been buried because they weren't allowed into consecrated ground.
Wow.
Because they weren't considered to be part of the Christian community, so they were excluded. And I just think this would have been totally horrific because if a baby died and it had been baptised, the parents would have had the comfort of knowing it was going to heaven, you know, and these people would have been very devout.
Absolutely.
And totally believed, you know, what they were being told by the Catholic Church. So if the baby died before it was baptized and the parents were told it was destined for limbo, that must have been horrific. So I think these are very poignant sites. And again, you know, it is hard to study the remains of these very young infants. But I think, again, it's important that their little voices are heard and especially the voices of their families, because what I found is that in these burial grounds, even though they were excluded from formal burial practice and they weren't allowed into the churchyards, you find that basically they're buried in exactly the same way, and you find evidence of quartz, and so in some you even find like little toy figurines or little dice. And again, I just think they're so imbued with emotion, and that those families were really suffering, but they were trying to make sure their little infants, you know, were as comfortable and maybe giving them toys so they wouldn't be bored in the afterlife in limbo. And a lot of these unconsecrated burial grounds have now been blessed by priests, you know, especially around the turn of the millennium. And kind of, it was almost like the wrong was righted.
Yeah.
But I think, yes, that's been a very challenging area to work in, but one that I think is really important.
Yeah. I love that word, imbued.
Imbued.
I think that's a lovely, lovely word. If you could take anyone from Northern Ireland dead or alive, it's really tough for you.
God.
Out for a cup of coffee, who would you take? Where would you take them and why?
Okay, so if, well, they're actually, I was going to say one alive, one dead, but they're both dead, sadly. So in terms of a modern person, I think I would really like to go out for coffee with Seamus Heaney. Because, you know, Seamus Heaney, a lot of his poems, you know, they're very, there's a very strong sense of place in his poetry.
Massive.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
But he's also very interested in the past, you know, the more recent past, but also the deeper past, the archaeological past. And, you know, a lot of his poems feature archaeological, you know, monuments or discoveries. So for like, for example, one of my favourite monuments is the Janus figure in County Fermanagh, and that features in Heaney's poem. So I think he'd be really interesting to get chatting to. And we've got our big European Association of Archaeology conference coming to Belfast next year. So it'll be like 2,500 archaeologists descending on the city, which will be very interesting because we like to party and socialise. But we've actually got as our conference motto, weaving narratives, and we've got the Janus figure as our sort of logo.
Nice.
And that's kind of hearkening to, you know, Belfast being part of, you know, Linenopolis and the weaving, but also it being, a centre of great poetry and the works of people like Seamus Heaney. So I'd love to kind of get his insight and some advice for this EAA conference and what he might, what he would think about it and bringing poetry into it. In terms of a long dead person, I think I would bring the poor Armoy leprosy sufferer out, because I think they've had a really horrible life, you know, suffering from a disease that would have been really debilitating. And I think I would just want to be able to tell their story properly, because I've only been able to really talk about them in terms of the scientific and how their body would have been affected. So they're also quite a late case. So they were sort of 15th, 16th century, whereas at that time, leprosy would have been dying out. And tuberculosis would have becoming a more prominent disease. So I do wonder, had they travelled somewhere, or how did they actually get the disease, and how did they end up inside the church at Armoy? So they would be really intriguing to talk to.
Class. You know? Final question then, Eileen. If you could go back in time to an 18-year-old version of yourself, and you had a couple of minutes of 18-year-old Eileen's time, what sort of things would you say to her?
What would I say? Stop chasing boys. Spend far too much time being interested. I would just say, enjoy yourself and seize every opportunity. Don't be afraid, you know, because I think a lot of times we hold ourselves back, you know, and especially I think girls, young women tend to not just go for things because they're worried about if it goes wrong. You know, life is full of, you know, we make mistakes, but they're rarely all that terrible, and you might be embarrassed for a bit, but you get over it.
Yeah.
And I just think, yeah, go for it, seize every opportunity. Obviously, the world we're living in now with COVID, we're all sort of getting used to travelling again, but I think it's brilliant to be able to travel and to experience other cultures and, you know, to bring those experiences back home.
Yeah.
You know, because like I said, I'm a real home bird and I wanted to stay in Northern Ireland, and I'm so happy that I've been able to. But I've enjoyed travelling the world as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Awesome. Well, this was a lot of fun. I feel like I've learned so much. My head's absolutely spinning off the head here.
I hope I haven't told you a whole pile of nonsense.
No, awesome. Really, really cool stuff. Like, thank you so much for giving up your time to do this. Really appreciate it.
No problem. And hopefully the Queen's guys will be happy with what we've...
Yeah, 100%. And big thanks to them for making this one possible. I just pulled it up there. I might actually end the episode with reading out that Seamus Heaney quote you sent through. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just thought it was really lovely, you know.
All right. Well, here we go. Sensitivity to the past contributes to our lives in a necessary and salutary way. It's not just a temperamental or intellectual accident, like a talent for chess or a passion for whiskey, but a fundamental human gift that is potentially as life-enhancing and civilizing as our gift for love. And that's Seamus Heaney, 1993, History of Ireland magazine. Eileen, thank you. Really appreciate it.
Perfect. No, thank you. It's been fun.